excitement, and I welcome you to our very first program here on BCTV about the food and farm industry here in Berks County. And today we are going to be launching a video called Berks Cooks. Berks Cooks was created by students at the Berks Career and Technology Center West Campus, close to Leesport, and close to the Berks County Ag Center. And we greatly appreciate their assistance in bringing to you information about a topic that's very appropriate for this Good Friday, and that is Berks County's lamb industry. The BCTC students actually helped us create a video that is all about cooking lamb. And Chef Pierre Wigon, who is from the BCTC East Campus, was our guest chef for that video program, which was hosted by Berks County's Agricultural Preservation Office staff person, Kim Fee. So we had a lot of volunteers helping us create this program, which we'll be showing just in just a few minutes, so we hope that you'll enjoy it and learn a little bit more about how to prepare lamb. But before we actually talk about cooking lamb, what we want to do is talk about the sheep industry here in Berks County. And with me today is Roger Bowman. Roger Bowman owns Winterside Farm near Lenhartsville. And Roger has been in the sheep business for how many years, Roger?
Oh, I guess it's about 37 years. My wife Nancy and I have been farming with sheep.
Mm-hmm. And Roger is a retired school teacher, and as a sideline all over those 37 years, he has been raising sheep for not only meat, but also for what you see in front of us, which is their fleeces, and to create these beautiful products from their wool. So Roger, just share with us a little bit this morning about your farm, how big it is, and how many sheep do you run?
Okay. We have a 25-acre farm in Greenwich Township, just east of Lenhartsville on Old 22. We have most of our farm is in woodland, but we do have some pasture and pasture, and then we also crop farm, mostly hay and corn, about another 15 acres to supply food for the sheep. We currently have about 40 to 45 brood ewes, and we have two different kinds of sheep on the farm. Mm-hmm. We have a Dorset sheep, which is more of a meat breed, where the focus in the breeding is on developing fast-growing meat animals. And then we also have Corriedale sheep, and Corriedale are a dual-purpose sheep, but there's more emphasis on the wool.
Okay, and you know, here on the table we actually have a fleece from one, and which would this be from, the Corriedale?
This would be from Corriedale, mm-hmm. Yes.
And yeah. You can see the fibers here on this fleece, and of course we're looking at it, and it's traditionally white, as we right. think of most sheep, but as we all know that nursery rhyme and the black sheep, bah bah black sheep, you know, there are some sheep that are colored wool, correct?
Right, yeah, for thousands of years black sheep were discriminated against, uh-huh. and any sheep that had a black mark on it was taken out because white wool dies easily, and when you sell your wool commercially, if there's any black spots in the wool, when the commercial processor tries to dye this, the black isn't going to take the dye and it messes up the color. So, but now lately there are a lot more people going into hand spinning and doing home craft type things, and now I would say for about the last maybe 10-15 years there's been a definite market for what we call natural colored sheep, mm-hmm. black and brown and various colors.
Uh-huh. Wow. I didn't realize that there was getting to be a more of a market.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
What we see in front of us also are some of the things that you've created, the yarn and some of these beautiful shawls and a purse that you have out yeah. front. Tell us a little bit about these, Roger.
Well, for years, the selling your wool commercially wasn't very economical. It was actually costing you more to shear the sheep at some point than you got for the wool. So we decided, Nancy and I decided, that we wanted to add some value to our product. So since we do have Corriedale sheep that have a higher value on their wool, we started getting it spun and dyed, and send it away to get processed. And then to add even more value to it, I started trying to weave, and I picked up a few looms along the way, and I do this sort of as a hobby, but yet it's our business.
Mm-hmm. Right. And now, especially since you're no longer teaching school, you know, this becomes more important all the time. Now, when we look at this shawl, Roger, we see black and red and white. How do you know what colors and how to put that on the loom?
Well, it's just your own artistic guess at what you think it would look nice. And I like experimenting. I guess that's, since I'm a scientist, I was a science teacher, this is part of it, it adds to it. I just experiment with different colors and I think, well, what's going to look together and good together? And I go ahead and I just try it. Now this particular shawl has something special to it, with it. Some of the yarn that's in here is not 100% wool. Some of it has mohair in it, and mohair comes from Angora goats.
Mm-hmm. So it's actually a combination between goats and sheep. And,
right.
And over the years, many people did run goats and sheep in flocks, but tell us a little bit about the differences between someone who has goats and someone who has sheep.
Well, actually, they're two different species. And when you shear a sheep, some people confuse it with a goat because they do look somewhat similar when the sheep is shorn. But goats are more of a, they're actually two different species, like I said, but goats are more of a browser type animal. And they, if you let them out in a field somewhere, they're going to go after shrubs and bushes and things of that nature. Whereas sheep are grazers, and they prefer grass and vegetation that's low to the ground. Sheep are generally more heavily muscled. And they'll develop more meat on them than a goat will. One thing I found that's interesting, if you're never sure if it's a goat or a sheep, look at its tail. Because goats tend to have, when they're walking around, have the tail up in the air, and sheep generally the tail would hang down.
Drop it down, yeah.
Although on most sheep now we dock the tails,
right.
Take them off for sanitary reasons.
Right. Well, and now with the higher price of gas, maybe more people will be looking for sheep and goats to trim their yards and keep things under control. But actually, that is a practice where people are utilizing sheep and goats to keep weeds under control, even under power lines.
Right, exactly. In fact, we've just enclosed an area on our farm that's under a power line to help keep it'll help the MedEd keep their weeds down under their power line.
Mm-hmm.
But there are actually businesses, there are some farmers that will have maybe 1,000 or 2,000 head of sheep, and they make a business out of going around the country grazing in clover leaves and under power lines and things like that. They'll hire shepherds to follow along with the sheep, and they'll have dogs to keep the sheep in a confined area.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, thousands of sheep in a flock are something a little different than what we have in Berks County.
Right.
How many sheep do you think we have here in Berks County, and how many people raising sheep? Are there a lot?
That's a hard question to answer, because here in the East, and particularly in Pennsylvania, we have smaller flocks. We have probably one of the larger flocks in Berks County. Right now with our lamb crop, we have maybe about 100 sheep on the property.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one of the bigger flocks in the county.
Mm-hmm.
If I were to guess, I would say there might be 150 farms that have sheep on them. Some of them may only have two or three.
Mm-hmm.
Numbers of sheep, again, I don't have an accurate number on that, but I would guess somewhere in maybe 8,000, but that's a guess on my part. Now, Pennsylvania, if you ask me about Pennsylvania, I can give you a little better details on that.
Go ahead.
Pennsylvania is actually 15th in the nation on numbers of sheep, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And we're actually 4th in the nation in number of sheep operations.
Well, that's very significant, and
that's
one of the reasons why we are doing this show, which is to show people the importance of adding lamb to their diet, and that it's actually a fairly easy meal to make, and one that will not only be good for them, but will be good for Berks County's sheep industry. So at this point, Roger, why don't we take a look at this new video, Berks Cooks, and learn a little bit more about preparing lamb.
Sounds good to me.
We'll be right back. welcome to Berks Cooked. I'm your host, Kim Fees, and the purpose of this show is to educate you about some of the wonderful and locally grown food from right here in Berks County, and to inspire you to use these ingredients in your everyday cooking. The focus of today's program is how to use locally raised lamb in some of the unique and simple recipes that anyone can make. And to show us some of those unique and simple recipes, we are joined by Chef Pierre Wigan, the culinary arts instructor from the Berks Career and Technologies East Campus. Chef Pierre, welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us.
Mm-hmm. Happy to be here.
Chef, when people think about lamb, they think about Easter, they think about the leg of lamb, and something special for the occasion and the holiday gathering. Lamb's always something that the average individual really is afraid to attempt. Why is that?
Well, I think because it's not one of your regular type meats that we're used to using for the holidays, like turkey and ham and beef. But it's a little, intimidating, first of all, because it's expensive to buy a leg of lamb or a rack of lamb. And then when you buy an expensive piece of meat, you really don't want to mess it up. You know, you don't want to ruin it. So you want to, kind of stay away from those types of cuts of meat.
So today, you're going to show us some simple and easy recipes using ground lamb, correct?
Absolutely.
What do you have for us today?
Okay, well, we're going to have a little basic lamb meatball recipe, and then I'm going to show you how to make a stew or a ragu and incorporate those two things together into something that's really delicious and tasty. What's neat about this is that with a minimal amount of cooking time, you have a lot of complex flavors that are all put together to make something really delicious.
Great. What's the first step?
Okay, the first step is to take our ground lamb. This lamb is Berks County lamb. It comes from Winterside Farm in Lenhartsville, and it was donated to us by the farmer there who raises the lamb. We have a pound and a half of ground lamb that we have in our bowl, and when you're making a basic meatball, you start with your meat, and then you have to think about the moisture and the binder, and then you think about your seasonings. And our binder today is going to be egg and bread crumbs. So I'm going to moisten my bread crumbs first with a little bit of red wine. It's about a cup and a half of bread crumbs, and I'm going to drizzle 3 tablespoons of red wine on those breadcrumbs. And that'll help give us a little moisture. You could use milk or chicken stock or even water if you wanted. So we're going to mix that up a little bit and just... Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do are add my seasonings. I have chopped onion. I have garlic, chopped garlic. I have parsley. I have salt and pepper. Salt and pepper, of course, is very important, especially the salt more than anything else. And with the pepper, there's a little cayenne, too, that's going to give it a little zip. And I have some herbs de Provence. Okay, me being French, rather than using Italian seasoning, I'm going to use some French seasoning.
Excellent.
And the French seasoning, the herbs, is a mixture of basil, oregano, thyme, and lavender. And then I'm going to add a little coriander to it as well. Coriander is a Middle Eastern spice, and it's available in seeds or ground. This is the ground stuff. Coriander is has a lot of aroma and flower, a lot of flavor to it. Okay, so we're going to take our egg and just
now while
mix
you're
it
mixing
up a little
that
bit.
Up, what are some of the benefits of using lamb?
Well, lamb is great because it's a little stronger meat in flavor, so a lot of other flavors hold up to it really well. You could use curry, cinnamon, a lot of strong spices.
It really seems like in a lot of different cultures that lamb is often used.
Absolutely, especially in Mediterranean cultures, in Greece and Italy and Northern Africa. They use lamb a lot, and they use a lot of strong seasonings. It holds up really well to strong, robust flavors.
And we have ground lamb here. What part of the lamb does that come from?
Okay. Today we're using the lamb that comes from the shoulder. The shoulder, you could use the ground lamb from the shoulder or the breast of the lamb. The fat proportion ratio of meat, lean meat to fat is actually perfect. It's 20%. Which gives it good flavor and moisture. Typically, you would use ground meat. The lamb would be from the shoulder or the
right.
breast.
Right.
All right. So we're mixing this up now.
Now we're going to make meatballs here,
absolutely.
Right? And how many meatballs are we going to get out of this?
Well, I think we're going to get quite a few. I'm looking at about. When I made this before, I used a slightly larger meatball, and I got about 18. And today I'm going to make them a little bit smaller, so I'm looking at maybe getting 24, just between 24 and 30.
And of course, it just, you know, depending on what you're using the meatballs for and what the size you're making, that's how many you're going to get out. But
absolutely. All right.
So you just mix that up really well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you have any tricks or tips on how to make that perfect little round meatball?
Well, actually, I'm going to use a portion scoop. That way, I'm guaranteed that the meatballs will all be exactly the same size.
All right. So that's our trick number one
yeah.
for the day?
Now, the meatballs should feel a little sticky. If they're not sticky, then you know you don't have enough moisture. So I would add a little bit more wine, maybe.
And you don't have anything then to help bind it together, to keep them together if you don't have the moisture?
Exactly. Then they tend to be on the dry side.
Okay.
All right. You could also use breadcrumbs if you wanted instead of the bread cubes. The breadcrumbs are going to give you a slightly more dense product, maybe a little bit drier. Okay.
And lamb is, some of the benefits for lamb as far as nutritional value, high
okay.
protein content?
Protein, iron, niacin, vitamin B12. It's got a nice, the fat is has a not as much cholesterol.
Okay.
As typical ground beef.
Okay.
It would be a little bit more healthy. There is some saturated fat, but not that much
right.
compared to other ground meat.
So it's really, it's a good healthy alternative to ground beef. You could pretty much, anything you would do with a ground beef meatball, you could use this same meatball. You would just adjust your spices and stuff to whatever the ethnicity of the dish that you're making?
Absolutely. Meatballs are a item that transcend all cultural, you know, barriers. The Swedish people make them with cream sauces and mushrooms, and the Asians do them with cilantros and curries, and they do them with Asian spices and chutneys like mango and fruit, and then the Italians, of course. Do you know they blend the
traditional
meat,
one
the
we
traditional
all think of, I
with
think.
The marinara sauce.
Right, right.
So, all right. Okay, so we'll stop here. I think that's enough meatballs
sure.
for our little demonstration. And I'm going to put this aside for a while, and people at home can actually make these up ahead of time and put them in the refrigerator for about 30 minutes, and then that's going to let the flavors
right.
kind of just
okay.
marinate a little bit.
So what are we moving on to now then?
Okay, so while we're letting these flavors kind of marinate, we're going to move on to making our stew.
Okay.
So the first thing we want to do when we make our stew is to saute the mushrooms.
Go ahead and just holler if there's anything I
all
can
right.
give you a hand with.
I'm just going to tidy up a little bit. Please bear with me.
That's all right. That's okay.
You know, these chefs, they're big on sanitation.
I understand that. Got to keep everything clean. So you just got to let the pan warm then a little bit
We're
also till you saute
warm,
mushrooms?
Very hot, yeah.
So there's a trick when you saute mushrooms. Now I see here you have, is it a baby portobello here?
I have a baby portobello, but you can use any type of mushroom. You could use the white, the typical traditional white button mushroom. You could use shiitakes, chanterelles, anything you want.
So anytime I'm sauteing mushrooms, though, they tell you have to be careful for the moisture to come out. You want to heat them at a hot temperature quick or low and slow? What is the best way?
I'm thinking hot and quick.
Okay,
You just want to get them sweating a little bit. You want to give them a little bit of color. They're going to really complete their cooking once we put them in the stew.
Okay. And I just wondered if I forgot to say earlier, all these recipes you have made available.
Absolutely.
On the Berks County Ag Coordinator website.
Yes.
Those recipes will be available, and some other additional products that we're going to show you. There'll also be a list of different producers where you can buy this local produce. And in Berks County, we've started something called Bountiful Berks. I don't know if you've heard about it. It kind of takes on the buy local, buy fresh trend. We've had different producers in the county sign up for the Bountiful Berks logo. Surefine stores and Redner's stores will be producing some of these logos and providing the produce that has these logos, and they'll feature those in their stores over the time. It's in infancy, but we want to get the name out of Bountiful Berks, certainly, and get people to promote that buy local and buy fresh.
Well, I'll be definitely looking for that when I go to the local supermarkets.
Yeah.
So I'm just quick sauteing these a little bit over the highest heat that this can produce. I can hear some little sizzling going on, and we're getting some of the smell of the mushrooms developing here.
And approximately how many mushrooms were that?
This is 18 ounces.
Okay. Do you think there's a difference buying a fresh mushroom and slicing it yourself or buying the sliced mushrooms?
I like to buy the sliced mushrooms.
For ease and convenience?
Yes, absolutely.
All right.
You know, that's what's wonderful about today's markets. Everything's done for convenience. And if you're a chef, you know, you want a little convenience too, because
you're taking your time with your other portions of the meal.
Absolutely.
Now when you're sweating the mushrooms and you're just kind of seeing that moisture cook out of them a little bit.
Exactly.
That intensifies the flavor of
Absolutely.
The mushroom then.
Absolutely, yeah. We're getting a little smell going on here and a little color. A little browning, caramelization, it's called. So just going to give this about 2 more minutes, and then we're going to remove the mushrooms, and we're going to start with our next step.
And put the mushrooms right back
into
that container?
We're going to put the mushrooms right back in there.
Great. I think I could eat them just like that.
Yeah.
Now you used olive oil. Some people would still maybe traditionally use butter, or you don't want that flavor of the butter. You
could
prefer the olive oil.
I like olive oil because
Certainly
I like the flavor that it has, and it's definitely something, if you're health conscious, the olive oil is a very good natural oil. But you could use a mixture of oil and butter. You could use all butter. We're going to be adding quite a bit of butter at the end to thicken our sauce, so... I'm starting out with the mushrooms. All right. So this is looking really nice here.
Okay.
Right? So we're going to set these off now. Excuse me.
That's all right.
And then we are going to add I guess I'll put a little more oil in there. Let's see, I have some down here. And we're going to add our onions. Our pan's nice and hot now, which is good. And we're going to add our celery. Carrots. And we're going to let that cook
Now, if you were down and added green pepper, that would be the Trinity, right? So is there a name for...
This is basically a mirepoix, although the proportions are not that of a mirepoix. But a mirepoix is a good flavoring mixture. It's usually a mixture of carrots, celery, and onions. And the onions are twice the amount in a ratio of the carrots and the celery.
Okay.
But this is not your traditional mirepoix because the ingredients are all pretty much equal. So we're just giving that a little cooking, sautéing there for about 4 minutes. Again, your onions and your celery, your carrots are sweating, and we're developing some good basic flavor here.
And as you do these different stages, then you're kind of like layering the flavors, and you have the mushrooms in their set. Now you're building another flavor.
Absolutely.
And building another flavor.
Yep. So next I'm going to add my garlic, a little chopped garlic, and I'm going to put a bay leaf or two in there, and I'm going to use some fresh thyme.
And I saw how you did that, and I do that a little bit slower.
All right, well, actually, thyme grows with a woody stem. And
so
if I pulled it like this with the stem typically breaks. So I kind of do it the opposite way and hold on to the stem and then just pull those fine, delicate thyme leaves.
So this combination is the fresh herb combination of the ground herbs that you had used, or the dried herbs, excuse me, that you had used before.
Yeah, this is actually, you're correct. All right, so now let this cook for about another minute with the fresh thyme and the garlic and the bay. And I'm going to get my wine ready. And I've used a red wine. This is a Cabernet.
And when you cook
and
with wine, they say use the same ones that you would drink. You don't have to go terribly inexpensive, but at the same time you don't have to go terribly expensive.
Typically I don't use an expensive wine for cooking. Just an ordinary house, wine, whatever's on sale at the state store is
perfect.
Okay. I wouldn't waste a good, expensive cooking wine.
If you use a Cabernet in this recipe,
yeah.
Is that also what you'd pair the dish then with in the end, or does it not always run that way?
It depends. I'm a white wine drinker, so I might not want to drink red wine with this meal. But typically with lamb, you would use a red wine, like a Pinot or a Beaujolais or a Merlot or maybe even a Cabernet. Would marry very well because, again, the lamb has really strong, robust flavors that pair well with...
With a stronger...
Absolutely.
...tastier wine. Okay.
So let's see here. I'm just checking my recipe real quickly, and it looks like we're putting in, this is almost, putting in about a cup and a half, and we're letting that cook down to reduce.
And when you say reduce, that's just the alcohol cooks out of it, and
it's just all going to evaporate. You're concentrating the flavors. We're going to cook this now until there's hardly any wine left whatsoever.
Oh, okay.
Well, we're having a little bit of a technical difficulty with this program, so we're going to just hopefully talk a little bit about the fact that The recipes for this Berks Cooks program are actually going to be available at the Berks County Ag Center through my office. And also, I'm leaving a few copies here that folks could stop in the BCTV studio and pick up a recipe if they're interested in getting these. But sounds pretty flavorful at this point, don't you think, Roger?
It sure does. I'm getting very hungry just watching the program.
Well, now, when you're at home and having your meat processed from your sheep and lambs, you actually offer freezer lamb at your farm for people to come in. What would be the difference between buying lamb for the freezer or if they go to a retail outlet and buying it by the cut?
Well, it's good. First of all, it's going to be more economical to buy it as a whole freezer lamb. When you go to the store, the advantage of going to the store, of course, is you can buy just those cuts that you want. But when you buy a freezer lamb, basically what you're going to get is the leg of lamb. But then you can have it cut. You know, we have a butcher that will custom cut to however you want it cut. Some people want the leg cut in half, or if they have a larger family, they might want the whole leg. They will also get the chops. The loin is the most expensive part of the sheep.
Mm-hmm. Kind of like steaks and a beef, you know.
Exactly, okay. Right. And then you have, as Chef Pierre talked about, you have the shoulder and the brisket, the breast area. Now, the shoulder, you can do different things. With the shoulder, you can actually have that cut into steaks or chops. And mm-hmm. some people do that because they want more of that. For the housewife, that's a little quicker to cook.
Right.
Or you could have it ground, as Chef Pierre talked about, and have more ground for other kinds of dishes.
Right. And as they were saying, you can substitute that for meatloaf or anywhere where you would normally either use ground beef, just substitute in the lamb. And now, many times when I see lamb served, they have a mint sauce. What's the significance between that and the lamb?
Well, to tell you the truth, I'm not quite sure.
Okay.
But it does have a stronger, different kind of flavor to it. And Chef Pierre was talking about a little bit stronger flavor in the lamb. And I imagine it's to complement that. Mm-hmm. One of the things, if you're talking about strong flavor, I think that depends a lot on the age of your sheep and what kind of sheep you have. Normally, if you're buying here in the United States, in America, we consider lamb to be a sheep to be a lamb until it's 1 year old.
Mm-hmm.
If you buy lamb from Australia or New Zealand, they often consider it lamb till they're 2 years old.
Oh, wow.
And as the animal gets older, the flavor may get a little bit stronger.
Right.
The American sheep producers, we try to push American lamb because it'll be a little more mild in flavor, I guess you would say.
Right, and the others, we have heard of the term mutton, which mm-hmm. is the older sheep.
Right.
And, of course, then, as you said, the stronger flavor, the right. older the animal gets.
And some of that depends, too, on who's eating the lamb. Right now, the lamb market, the sheep market here in the United States is hot,
mm-hmm.
The same as beef. The prices are up quite a bit, but the reason the lamb prices have jumped so much is because of the ethnic market. About 80% of the lamb that's eaten in the United States is eaten on the East Coast, between Boston and Washington, D.C.
Oh, wow.
And guess where we sit?
Right
in the middle of that. We should be seeing a lot more sheep and lambs in Berks County.
Right.
And the best lamb market right now, sheep market in the country, in minds of most shepherds, is right in our neighboring county at New Holland.
At New Holland, yeah.
Yeah, prices in the last couple, now we're here at Easter time when lamb normally goes up in price, but right now lamb is selling on the hoof around $2.30 to $2.40 a pound.
Mm-hmm. Well, and the thing that we seem to find more difficult here in the East is getting it processed. You know,
right.
if we would add more farmers having sheep on their mm-hmm. farms, one of the challenges we all have today is the fact that over the years, many of our small town butchers mm-hmm. have gone out of business.
Mm-hmm.
So finding someone to actually process the lamb into, you know, meat products for people to consume is a little more challenging at times.
Yeah, I agree with that, and that has become a bit of a problem. You know, 30 years ago, 37 years ago when we started, there were a number of different butcher shops that you could go to, and now I'm down to basically two within our local area.
Right, and that's something that I think for the whole Bountiful Berks and the initiative to buy local and support our local agriculture economy, we need to see how can we go about restoring some of these small meat processors in our area so that Berks County farmers don't have to go traveling to other counties in order to get that done. So it's a challenge, but one that I think hopefully we'll be able to work with various groups to try and solve that problem. I talked with the Berks Career and Technology Center about, is there a possibility of adding that as a curriculum for adult education at some point, or even offering it to young people minus the sharp instruments, you know, because we certainly need to be careful about that. But I know that both the Berks Career and Technology Center East and West campuses, plus Reading, Muhlenberg Votech, offer wonderful culinary courses that young people can learn a lot more about the food industry.
I think another issue on that area is the state government, I think, has to be involved, the Department of Health or whatever, because when I talk to some of the local butchers as to why aren't you processing lamb anymore, it's because of the restrictions that the government is putting on.
Now, well, we all want that's federal, not state.
I'm sorry, excuse me, yes. Well, yeah, federal, USDA.
Right, USDA, because in Pennsylvania, while some states do have state inspectors for meat processors, in Pennsylvania, our state government actually did not take that on, but allowed the USDA to go ahead and do that. But you're right, a lot of that has created some issues for and has driven quite a few small meat processors out of business. So, well, I'm hoping that, you know, again, more people will enjoy this and pick up the recipe either here at BCTV studio or by calling my office, and I'm sure Roger you'll have some of those at your Winterside farm as well. So why don't we try and go back to our program here and see how things go.
Good.
Cook this for about 8 more minutes. All right. And this just splashed a little bit and it spit, so now I know.
So now you know it's hot enough.
My oil's hot.
So I see you're taking a little bit of a step back there. I'm going to guess this is going to spark a little bit.
I think it will, yeah.
Okay. Now you're an experience. You drop those in, you'll put those in with your hand, or I know sometimes they say you can get a little further away and drop them in with a spoon.
I could drop them in with a spoon too. I probably would use my hand. You don't want to crowd the pan too much, so maybe do half at a time.
Do half all. So you're prepping everything to get them ready.
Yeah, because these are still cold, and you don't want the temperature of the heat to change. You know, you want to keep it nice and hot.
In the oil to be consistent.
Right. If you crowd the pan too much and put them all in, then you lower the heat of your oil.
And
so
you don't,
then it takes a recovery time then.
So you're really hindering the quality of the kind of, it might get done a couple minutes faster.
Yeah, but then you don't get your nice dark caramelization or that Maillard effect that is nice. And you can gently just toss them around a little bit using a little fork. They're cooking really nicely.
Very quickly. Cooking
they are. They're cooking great.
That's certainly starting to simmer away.
Yeah, I think we're going to turn that heat down a little bit now that we have a simmer.
What are some of your other favorite foods to cook up?
I like stews a lot. I like braising. I like things where there's a lot of gravy and sauces, especially in the wintertime. when you can't grill outside, you know, because of this, all the snow.
Oh, yes. what are some of your things to instruct? Like, what part of the instruction do you like? Is it the science behind it, the theory behind cooking, or is it the actual getting your hands dirty and cooking?
Well, you know, the science is all well and good, but with students, you know, they get weary of being in theory. So we want to keep those lessons to like 20, 40 minutes per day. And then the rest of the time, the students, especially Berks County kids, they like to be working. They're hard workers. They're from working stock. So they like to be in the kitchen. They like to be moving. They like to be doing things. And I like giving demonstrations to the students. And I like teaching knife skills and vegetable cuts. And the dry heat and the moist heat cooking techniques.
Do you think they'd have a particular favorite lesson that you provide them? Other than lamb meatballs now, which is going to be your
well,
next
they thing. They actually like working with meat and cutting meat into portion sizes, and they like deboning chickens and taking a chicken and turning it into, you know, different
portions
cuts,
of it.
Breasts, and they also like filleting fish. So those things are very exciting to them, and they're things that take practice and time, and the more they get to do that, you know, the better they feel about their career.
Right. Excellent.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find a lot of people in your program move on?
Well,
and get somehow.
Yeah, we do actually. I'd say between 40% and 50% either go out into the workforce right away after graduation or go on to higher education.
Okay.
And I must say that about 50% of my students right now are actually working in local businesses in Berks County, either at restaurants or pizza shops or nursing homes. You know,
in the field already.
Absolutely. That's awesome. Yeah, it's wonderful. So there is a lot of job potential. And as population keeps increasing, you know, there are more mouths to feed. So there are, you know, our these actually are done. So I'm going to take them out and transfer them onto my baking sheet here that's lined with some paper towel. And that's going to absorb any extra fat that we have here. And I'm ready to go with the final. I'm going to turn that down just a little bit. Getting some good heat going on here.
And how many meatballs did you figure, like, for a portion of this particular dish?
Well, these are a little bit, like, they're a medium size, so I think maybe four if for a smaller eater to six for a larger eater. And what's neat about the meatballs, too, are you can vary the sizes. So if you're doing this for an hors d'oeuvre, say Swedish meatballs, you could, you know, make the meatballs a little smaller, and then if you're doing them for an entree, you could make them a little bigger. I made them this size today only because I wanted to keep within cooking them within the 4 to 6 minute time range. But by all means, if you want to make them bigger, you know, absolutely.
And then we'll just as those finish up, then we're going to work on this, which is still simmering away quite nicely.
Yes, yes.
Will you do this? You have other dishes, and you're going to show us a little bit later.
I will.
Correct, that you
yes.
brought along some other
absolutely
easy, simple,
some easy simple stuff.
Lamb-based meatball dishes.
I was trying to find you know, a little bit of everything to show you, and I decided on a main course and then a salad and a sandwich. But like I said, you know, the meatballs are so versatile. You can use them in hors d'oeuvres. You can make mini ones and just soups.
So you can make these meatballs and then freeze them or keep them one hand or and then make these dishes? Do they freeze well once they're cooked?
Absolutely. They would freeze very well. In your home refrigerator, I wouldn't keep them more than a month.
Okay.
So, in a commercial freezer, you could make them a little, you could make them up ahead of time, and you could freeze them on sheet pans and then bag them up in baggies, you know, the Ziplocs, mm-hmm. and label and date them, and you could have them, you know, for future uses.
But you could take these meatballs, make a few extra, and then make all four dishes, the dishes that we're cooking here now, and then show us the other two dishes later on.
Absolutely. Yep, there's no reason why. And like these meatballs, you could actually make these the day before, too, and keep them in the refrigerator overnight.
Okay.
But you wouldn't want to keep them for more than one day overnight in the refrigerator before you cook them.
They do.
Yeah, they would just, the flavors would get too strong.
Okay.
You know? The onion starts to take over too much, so. But I think you'll be happy with the result.
All right, that doesn't take long at all,
to brown
those up.
To brown those up. It goes pretty quickly, and I like using the fork. I tried different utensils, but the fork actually works best to gently toss them around in the pan.
And really, you don't want to poke them with the fork. You just want to kind of move them around in the pan.
So they brown evenly all the way around, exactly.
But I know they say, like with a steak, you don't want to continually poke it.
No, a steak is different.
It's
different. Typically, with a steak, you would just turn it over once. You know, unless you're doing a crosshatch on it, then it would be, you would position it twice on one side and then flip it over the 45 and the 45. Yeah. But this, we got such nice heat here. I mean, these cooked up really, really quickly.
And I always like a recipe also, too, that you can do two things at once, and they both, at the end, come together.
Well, timing is essential, definitely. You know, you want to have things timed so that everything kind of comes together nice and easily for you at the end.
Sometimes I think that's one of the hardest parts about cooking different things, is that getting that timing set up. But this works very nicely.
I think that just kind of takes practice,
yeah.
You know. All right, so we're coming to the end here of our ragu, our stew. And you can see it has beautiful texture to it.
Yeah, and
it has
the celery and the onion in there and the carrots.
Yeah. Now, if you didn't want to make a stew with meatballs, you could serve meatballs with a variety of other things. You could do like a polenta, which is a cornmeal mash that's kind of soft. You could go with rice. It would work great with like a risotto, or you could serve it with mashed potatoes. So there's other ways to go.
Limitless.
You don't have to do, you know, the stew if you want. All right, so now we got our 8 minutes here, and we're going to add a little bit of butter and stir it in a little at a time.
And tell me what that butter is doing.
Well, it's going to thicken it just a little bit, and it's going to enrichen it a little bit.
Again, just kind of another.
We have absolutely no,
layer,
you know, besides the oil, we don't have. It's not really that rich, so we're making it a little richer, and this is helping to thicken it a little bit. Another way to thicken it would be to mash it a little bit. If you mash your beans,
okay,
you don't want to mash them all,
right?
But you could mash some of them, and that would help thicken your sauce a little bit too. And of course, the more you reduce this, the thicker it would get. And then I'm going to add the rest of my parsley. Let's see. I don't want to serve that.
You're going to pull out the bay leaf.
I'm going to pull out the bay leaf.
And then ideally, how far down would you let that? It's all in personal preference if you'd get it thicker or let it thinner?
Absolutely. It's personal preference and you could make it a little bit thicker, so you would just let it reduce a little bit longer.
And we're on a medium flame right now?
We're on a medium flame.
Mm-hmm. So just slowly.
There's another bay leaf. We're going to pull that out. All right, and I'm happy with this now. This is also something else you could make the day before if you wanted and reheat it if you're having company for dinner. But you're going to see this has such nice flavor and complex and robust things going on and within a little short amount of time. You know, you develop flavor with your mirepoix, you've got your mushrooms, you've got your wine, you know, you've got your stock. All right, so to serve this, we're going to portion it into a bowl like this.
That's that extra chef touch, wiping off
oh,
the end of the plate.
Oh, you always want to wipe
there.
Off the plate, yeah.
That looks great.
Does it look nice?
Yes, very much.
All right. And then I'm going to take some of these meatballs. How about how many meatballs could you eat, Kim?
Oh, I believe I'll go with three since you made all those. And
all
might
right.
as well enjoy them.
And then for somebody that has a bigger appetite, we could give them five or six. And then we're going to...
One final touch there on
the top. One final touch. I like some Parmesan cheese. And if you, that would be a nice ragu with Berks County meatballs.
There you go. Berks County lamb meatballs. Well, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
You brought some other items here, too. We just want to take a quick look at those.
Okay.
Okay, Pierre, thank you very much. We just made the meatballs. We made this great white bean ragu. Now, what else do you have to show us here with
the lamb?
All
right, well, just for the few minutes that we have left, I thought something quick and easy, a little salad, also incorporating some nice flavoring ingredients and robust things that really marry well with the lamb. So I'm going to take a little basic Dijon mustard.
So you're making us a basic salad dressing to start, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And then we have some honey, sweeten things up.
So far it's a honey mustard dressing.
Yeah. And then we're going to whisk in our lemon juice. This is fresh squeezed lemons. You could also use the bottled stuff. I've got a little something swimming in there.
I think that was a piece from a portion of the recipe in a little bit.
And then I'm going to add my oils. I have a plain vegetable oil.
And why whisk? Why not stirring? What is the benefit of whisking an oil in?
Whisking, you're getting an emulsion. You're kind of a temporary emulsion where you're blending, the vinegar or the lemon juice. I use lemon juice today, and that wouldn't really stay in an emulsion. It would want to separate. So the whisk kind of helps create a temporary emulsion.
So kind of the same reason why you shake your Italian dressing bottles is to
exactly.
to mix those
Although
things together.
See how it's getting a little
so
thick?
Thin,
and
yeah.
Isn't that
yeah,
beautiful?
Yeah.
So if you added an emulsifier like an egg yolk or some cornstarch or some flour, it would help keep this in emulsion if you didn't want to have to shake your oil and vinegar bottle. So I've got my oil, and now I'm just going to add some salt and pepper.
And so in a basic vinaigrette, well, you're not making a vinaigrette because you use the lemon juice?
I use the lemon juice for my acid.
Is there
yes.
anything in they would call this then?
No, it's still called a vinaigrette.
It's still a vinaigrette.
Yeah.
It's just you use, for your acid base, you use the lemon juice.
All right. So I'm going to, that's basically my salad dressing is done.
Okay.
And I don't really need too much. Going to put in about that. I don't like to put too much salad dressing in. You can always add more if you'd like. And
what greens are you going to use?
I'm going to use a nice, strong, spicy green, arugula.
And when you say spicy, is there anything particular that you can draw out of that?
Well, it has flavors of a little pepper and some licorice. And it marries very well with the lamb. It's a stronger green. It's not like a romaine or a leaf lettuce. You know, this really is going to give you...
Well, I'm sure that gave everybody an appetite for eating some wonderful Berks County lamb and all the trimmings. And I want to thank Chef Pierre Wigon from Berks Career and Technology Center East Campus for being our guest chef, and I also want to thank Roger Bowman, Winterside Farm, for providing that lamb for the chef to prepare, and Kim Fees, who was the host for Berks Cooks, our inaugural edition. I also want to thank the students who participated, Joe Lisa from Schuylkill Valley, Denzel James, Daniel Boone, Aaron Meehan from Brandywine, Jackson Kitchell from Daniel Boone, Chris Smith from Ole, David Yoder from Ole, Nate Washington from Boyertown, and Tom Schaefer from Governor Mifflin. And a special thanks to instructor Jim Del Conte from BCTC East. West, I'm sorry, I get the East and West confused. So again, I want to thank them so much for the providing us with the studio and for helping us get this organized. And just a little preview, they filmed last week at Roger Bowman's farm. So the sequel to Berks Cooks and Cooking Lamb is to actually spend the day with Roger on his farm in near Lenhartsville. In which township was that again?
That's Greenwich Township.
Greenwich Township. Mm-hmm. And actually get to see the sheep and learn a little bit more about the wool industry here in Berks County. Right. And again, Roger, I want to thank you. And you had wanted to say how many sheep we have in Pennsylvania.
Oh, yeah, I forgot to mention that earlier. There are 98,000 head of sheep in Pennsylvania right now.
98,000. Well, that's quite a few sheep. Yeah. And certainly at this time of year, people are thinking about lambs. So I want to wish you a happy Easter. And tune in again next time.